Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from one of the pastors here at the Rock.
Father, we thank you when we come to the throne of grace. Father, we are grateful. Grateful that we have an incredible King that loves us so much, that you made us and created us. And Lord, you weren't willing to leave us in the state that we were in, but you came, sacrificed yourself. You weren't willing to live without us. And so this morning, we approach your throne collectively as a family. We humbly ask that you would anoint our ears to hear, anoint our hearts to hear, anoint our eyes to see. Father, I ask that you'd encourage your mothers and your fathers in this house. Encourage your men and your women, your sons and your daughters, that they would know that with you, nothing is impossible. We bless all the churches in the Inland Empire and across this vast world, the great family of God that are naming the name of Jesus today, Father. Thank you that we are a privileged people to be called sons and daughters. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you've got your Bibles, we're going to be looking back in Hebrews. And this morning, the topic or the title of this message is A Mother's Faith. And as I said, we're going to be looking at two moms in the Old Testament. I'm going to be looking at Sarah, and Jess is going to be looking at Jochebed. But this morning, we want to teach you, and we want to teach ourselves and look at examples of faith. Because in the kingdom of God, faith is the economic system of heaven. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, let me tell you. When I studied economics in college, which was eons ago, and I don't remember much of it at all, but I did remember that there is, in every government, an economic system. There has to be. And it's titled and it's defined as that which moves goods and services. So in America, we have a free market system. Our economy is based on a free market. It moves goods and services back and forth, and we use the dollar. Well, God is the king, and he has the kingdom. When you and I got born of the Spirit of God, we were taken out of the kingdom of darkness, and we were brought into the kingdom of God. So now, even though we're in this world, we're not of it. If you're born of the Spirit of God, you are a new creation in Christ Jesus, and everything has become new. Now, you live in a world of material, a material world. It's called a corporeal world. It's a world of space and matter and time. But we know that there is a world beyond this that created this visible world that we now live in. And the invisible world created the visible world. So even though we're in this world, we're not of it. But we don't know how to operate in this invisible realm. We're learning. Would you say that's true? You can't see faith. You don't see God. It's not that you can touch and taste and smell and hear the invisible world. It's not there in our realm. So we have to walk by faith and not by sight. And in God's kingdom, he has established faith as the vehicle that moves goods and services. The things that are invisible that we need in our lives, the kingdom of heaven and the resources of heaven, are brought forth from the invisible to the visible world by faith. The just shall live by faith. We saw in Hebrews 11:1 that now faith is the substance. Even though it's invisible, it has substance, not corporeal substance, but it has real substance. It will take what is invisible and it will bring it into the visible world that we live in. Jesus demonstrated this as he walked on the earth. He showed us what it would be like to have a new nature and be like him and have the kingdom of heaven at your beck and call, at your call. He said, anything you ask in my name, if you believe it, I'll give it to you. When Jesus fed the 5,000 men plus thousands of women and children, he had 2 fish and 7 loaves, and yet he knew the kingdom. And so he knew that when he needed that resource to feed them, that there would be an invisible resource that would come and multiply the fish and the loaves. Are you with me? When there was a man with a withered hand in the synagogue on the Sabbath, and he looked at that withered hand, he said, come forth. And he healed that hand, and that hand grew out as a miracle. That was kingdom of heaven resource. Well, it's no different in our lives now. We're in this world, but we're not of it. And God has called us to this adventure of faith. He's called us to learn to live by faith. He's called us to walk by faith. He's called us to understand that even though we're in this material world, we are citizens of the invisible kingdom of God. And he has said, with God, nothing is impossible. Therefore, you and I have direct needs and direct wants in this 21st century life. And so we come to God and we pray and we ask God. We see a promise in the Word of God because faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. We know that God said we can have it. Let's take healing. So we say amen in that prayer. And that amen is actually a word that means, so be it, I believe it. And then over here, there is the hallelujah, which says, I've received it. It's manifested in my life. I don't have to believe anymore. I'm already healed. But between the amen, thank you, Lord, I believe it, and the hallelujah, thank you, Lord, I've received it, is the walk of faith. Because the journey of faith begins at the amen and it ends at the hallelujah when you've got it manifested in your physical life. Are you with me? Well, in the same way, these women are going to teach me how to live by faith and how to walk by faith when I'm raising my kids, because these are two moms that did the impossible. And because they were willing to believe God, they were able to bring in the plan of God to their family and change the destinies of their families and the destiny of my life. Therefore, I want to learn what they have to say to me. And so having said that and introduced this topic, and again, I say that heaven's economy, I believe, and this is just how I teach it, is faith. If you want to move something from the invisible world into the visible world, you're going to have to use faith. You're going to have to believe God. So go with me to Hebrews chapter 11. We're going to look at Sarah. And Sarah's life was a life of disappointment. She was a beautiful woman. On a scale of 1 to 10 in beauty, she would have been a 10. Sarah was so beautiful that kings wanted her. She was married to Abraham, and she traveled with him and walked with him and called him Lord, and she was an obedient wife and a beautiful wife. She was a great woman. But she had a problem, and the problem that Sarah had was that she could not have children. She was barren, and in the ancient world, if you could not have a child, you were worthless. You weren't fulfilling your creation role, and you were less than nothing. Even though she was beautiful, every month of every day of every year of every decade, she was disappointed because she could not have a child. Therefore, she lived with disappointment. Now, some of you in here today are disappointed. You're disappointed with your families, with what life has handed you, with the way things are. God hasn't seemed to come through. But you say, I want to look at Sarah's life because Sarah's going to show us how to overcome that. Are you ready? Hebrews 11. Let's look at verse 11. By faith, Sarah herself also received strength to conceive seed, and she bore a child when she was past the age because she judged him faithful who had promised. Verse 12, therefore, from one man and him as good as dead were born as many as the stars of the sky in multitude, innumerable as the sand which is by the seashore. So we're going to look at Sarah, and we see that Hebrews has her in the hall of faith, and she received strength to conceive when she was past the age of childbearing. So point one of my little topic and my point to you today is choose, like Sarah, to believe and not give up. If you're going to walk a walk of faith, and if we're going to learn from Sarah this morning, the point I want to make from her life is choose to believe God and don't give up. Choose to believe God and don't give up. Choose to believe God and don't give up. Because between the amen and the hallelujah, you are going to be challenged in every way your faith can be challenged. And you'll have a choice to stop believing and to give up and to lose destiny, or you will have a choice to not allow that to happen to your heart, because Satan's after our hearts, and choose to believe and keep going. So let's look at some things about how do we do that, and let's look at her life. Well, Sarah received strength to do the impossible when she was 90 years old. That's an impossible thing. And the point here is that God was saying something. Sarah, you're going to have a baby, but you're going to have a baby when you can't have a baby. Sarah and Abraham couldn't have Isaac until they couldn't have Isaac. Sarah and Abraham could not have Isaac until they couldn't have Isaac. What is God saying in that illustration? What God is saying in that illustration, in choosing to believe and not give up, is that this is not about what you can do and what I can do. This is not about how fertile your body is. It's not about how beautiful you are, how smart you are, how talented you are, all of the things that maybe life didn't hand you. It is not about what we can do. It is about what God says He will do through us. And it's not about your working so hard and killing yourself to make something happen, because, beloved, Sarah couldn't have Isaac and Abraham couldn't have Isaac until they couldn't have Isaac. Because God is saying, I don't need your flesh to get in the way. I need your faith to release my power and to show what I can do with the heart of a man or a woman that will simply believe me and walk in obedience. And I will do the impossible in your life. So looking at this, choosing to believe and not give up is my point. I'm going to have to remember that delays are not God's denials. It's going to take time for God to bring to pass what he wants to bring to pass. And just because something in your life is delayed, just because something in your life hasn't happened, just because it looks like God doesn't want to do it, it looks like it's just not going to happen. Remember, Sarah was 90 when she had Isaac. Abraham was 100 when he had Isaac. And they tried to have a baby naturally, and they had a surrogate baby named Ishmael, and Ishmael was not Isaac. Because in the 17th chapter of the book of Genesis, God comes to Abraham. And Ishmael is now 13 years old. And that surrogate motherhood thing did not work for them. It just caused division. Sarah had Hagar, her maid, go into Abraham. And out of Abraham's seed, Ishmael was born. So Abraham wasn't barren. Sarah was. Abraham was fertile. Sarah was barren. This is a lesson from Sarah. She couldn't have a baby, but she received strength to conceive. And this is what happened. In chapter 17 of the book of Genesis, God comes to Abraham. Ishmael is now 13 years old. And he says, I'm going to change your name from Abram to Abraham. I'm changing Sarai's name from Sarai, which means princess, to Sarah, which means mother of kings. And Abraham falls on his face before the Lord, and he laughs, and he said, shall Sarah have a child in her old age? Oh, that Ishmael would live before you, Lord, that you would consider this son that we created. And God said, no, I'm not going to allow Ishmael to be the son of the promise. I will give Ishmael a blessing, but through Sarah, your seed will be called, and your seed will be as the sands of the sea and as the stars of the sky, but it's through Sarah. God was not willing to leave Sarah out of his plan. So women, God is not willing to leave you out of his plan and destiny for your families. You are key to this. So then in chapter 18, God visits Abraham with two angels, and Sarah's in the tent. And God and Abraham have lunch. And God says, this time next year, Sarah, her name has been changed, will have a child. Now, Sarah, like any good wife, is eavesdropping in the tent. She is listening to what they're saying. She wasn't invited to the meal, so she's listening. Girls, that's who we are. And she laughed inside of herself, in her heart, when she heard that she's going to have a child at 90 years old. She laughed. And God says to Abraham outside the tent, why did Sarah laugh? I mean, do you love God? Do you think you can hide a thing from him? He can read our hearts. And Sarah says out loud from the tent, I didn't laugh. And I don't know if she came out and met God or what, but they have this conversation. And I don't know if they're talking between the tent canvas or if they're talking face to face. But God said, oh, but you did laugh. And so Abraham laughed the laugh of unbelief. And Sarah laughed the laugh of unbelief. Now let's fast forward. So God says she's going to have a baby. Delays are not denials. That's something to think about in choosing to walk by faith and not give up. The next thing I want to look at, because this took Sarah a long time, let's look at something else to consider in choosing to walk by faith and not give up, because these are things that are going to get in your way between the amen and the hallelujah. Are you following me? The second thing to consider about this today, and there's so many things, but today, my second point is that negative people and negative circumstances cannot stop the promise of God from coming and doing what he has promised to do in your life. The first one, our delays are not God's denials. The second one is negative people and negative circumstances cannot stop the promise of God from happening to you and to your life when you are walking by faith. It cannot. Now, let's see what happened. Well, chapter 19 is a parenthesis, Sodom and Gomorrah, and Abraham's talking to God about them. And then we travel to chapter 20 of the book of Genesis. In chapter 20, Sarah and Abraham pick up camp and they move to this place called Gerar. And Gerar has a king, his name is Abimelech. And Abimelech takes a look at Sarah, and he puts Sarah into his harem. Now wait, negative people and negative circumstances cannot stop the plan of God in your faith and in your walk of faith. King Abimelech is putting Sarah in his harem. Could be a problem, do you think? Abraham, you and Sarah are going to have a baby. His name is going to be Isaac. And in Isaac, your seed will be called. But here comes King Abimelech. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but if King Abimelech sleeps with Sarah and has a baby, that is not going to be Abraham's baby. Are you with me? Therefore, there were some negative people here. Abraham was afraid, and he told Sarah to tell the king that she was his sister, which was only a half-truth and a half-lie. So I don't know what that means, because we all do that all the time. She was his half-sister. Negative people and negative circumstances cannot stop the plan of God, because here's what happened. God comes to Abimelech in the middle of the night in a dream, and he says, Abimelech, you are a dead king if you touch her. Let's read it. Genesis. Abraham said of Sarah, she is my wife, she is my sister. And Abimelech, king of Gerar, sent and took Sarah, but God came to Abimelech in a dream by night and said to him, indeed, you are a dead man because of the woman whom you've taken, for she is a man's wife. But Abimelech had not come near her, and he said, Lord, will you slay a righteous nation also? Did he not say to me, she's my sister? And she herself said, he's my brother. In the integrity of my heart and the innocence of my hands, I have done this. And God says to him in the dream, yes, I know that you did this in the integrity of your heart, for I also withheld you from sinning against me. Therefore, I did not let you touch her. Now, therefore, restore the man's wife, for he is a prophet, and he will pray for you, and you shall live. But if you do not restore her, know that you shall surely die, you and all who are yours. My point is that negative people and negative circumstances cannot stop what God has planned for you, because if he has to, he will go to a king and give him a dream and tell him he's a dead man if he does what he's not supposed to do. God has you covered. He's got you covered outside, inside, north, south, east, west. He is the God that changes not. He's the God that does what he says he's going to do. That is why Sarah, in chapter 21, received strength to conceive. Now she had a notch on her faith belt. Now she saw how God had come through her life the whole way. And in chapter 21, it says that God visited Sarah and did to Sarah what he had promised. And in chapter 21, let me just read you this verse. And the Lord visited Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did for Sarah as he had spoken. He did for Sarah as he had spoken, despite the delays that seemed like it was never going to happen. He did for Sarah all that was spoken. Despite the fear of her husband, the negativity of Abraham, and he's a great man, and I'm not bashing Abraham. But sometimes our loved ones are not going to be in faith with us. That is not an excuse to not walk by faith yourself. Because your faith does not depend on your loved ones. Your faith depends on you and God. And it says that God, let me just finish this, for Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age. At the set time, God had spoken to him. God has a set time. And God said, and Sarah said, can I have the next part of the verse? And Abraham called the name of his son who was born to him, whom Sarah bore, Isaac. Let me just read mine. I don't know if they've got it or not. For Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age, at the set time of which God had spoken to her. Verse 6, and Sarah said, God has made me laugh. God has made me laugh. God has made me laugh, and all who are with me will laugh. There is a laugh of fear. There's a laugh of failure. There's a laugh of unbelief. But, beloved, God has called us to laugh the laugh of faith when the hallelujah has manifested, and it's here. And that is why Isaac is called laughter, because Sarah and Abraham could say, he is trustworthy, he is faithful, he is reliable. You can believe him. You can trust him. He is unchanging. And what he says he will do for your families and for you, he is faithful to do it.
Hallelujah. Amen. So good. Thank you, Mom. What a great word. We're going to continue on this theme of a mother's faith, and we're going to look at another woman in the Bible, and her name was Jochebed, and her husband's name was Amram. Now, that's interesting names, don't you think? Don't you want to just go out and name your children those names? Jochebed and Amram. These two people were pretty incredible, incredible men and women of God. But I want to talk about Jochebed, because she lived in a time where the world around her was incredibly dangerous, scary. It was a mess. You see, Pharaoh became king, and he did not like what he was seeing out of the Israel people. They were strong. They were multiplying fast. They were becoming a threat to him. And so he ordered the midwives to go as they would deliver babies, and if there was a male child, to throw that male child into the river where there were crocodiles, where it was dangerous, and kill the children. Now, here it is. The midwives are, you know, going, oh, man, we fear God too much. We do not want to be a part of this. And so they went back to Pharaoh, and they said this to him. They said, you don't get it. These Hebrew women, they're strong. They're like amazing. They're just having these children before we get there. And we can't, you know, carry out what it is you've asked us to do. So Pharaoh gets angry, and he calls everyone and all the guards and the whole land that if they find a male child, that those male children are to be thrown into the river to die. And so here's Jochebed. She's pregnant. She's a slave, and she's just a little no one of a lady. No one knew her. She wasn't a big name. And she's about to give birth. And she is knowing what's going on around her. She's in hell. Because she's hearing the cries of the moms that have lost their children. She's hearing death all around her. She's in an atmosphere of fear. She's in an atmosphere of no faith. She's in a scary moment. You know, back then, they didn't have ultrasounds to tell the women whether they were having a male child or a female child. So can you imagine what was going through her mind? When this child is born, what is it going to be? What am I going to experience? What am I going to have to face? And when Moses, who was her child, was born, she hid him for 3 months. If you would turn with me to Ephesians 11, 23. And it says in Ephesians 11, 23, by faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months with his parents because they saw that he was a beautiful child. And they were not afraid of the king's command. If we could learn anything from Jochebed, is that we could learn to choose faith over fear. This woman had to hide in her home with a newborn child. I don't know about you, but when my firstborn was new and she came home, all she did was scream her guts out. I mean, she cried and cried and cried, and I just cried and cried and cried right along with her. And it was not a quiet home anymore. There was no peace. It was not a calm atmosphere. So trying to hide a newborn is a big deal. Also, they did not live. Think about how we live. We live where we have a little bit of space. You know, kids, you're bothering me. Go downstairs, you know, or go to your room, or go here, or go outside and play. Then she could not do that. If she sent her children away, let's set this up for ourselves. What if her kids started talking? Just accidentally slipped. You know, oh, well, my brother was up all night last night. What, your brother? Your baby brother? You see, the family had to be in on this. This had to be something that they had to hide so that their brother Moses would not die. And Jochebed nursed him, and she took care of him, and then she had to release him. She had to hide him in faith, and then she had to release him in faith. She had to send him down the same river that he was told that he would die in. She put him in a basket, and she covered it with tar so that the water wouldn't fill the basket, and she let it go, and she asked her daughter Miriam to follow him, find out where he goes. She had no idea if Moses was going to live or if he was going to die. But do you know what she had? She had faith. She served a God, a big God. She knew that God knew that her son had a purpose and a plan and a destiny. She knew that death was not going to be his sentence. She was in faith, and she trusted the will of God. So as she sent him down, here's Moses. He gets picked up by Pharaoh's daughter. She finds him. And here's Miriam. says, oh, can I find you a wet nurse to nurse the baby for you? She said, yes, and I'll pay for it, and I'll take care of everything. And then you can send the child back to me. So guess what? Moses got to be with his mom longer. You know, the neatest thing for me is I can't imagine letting a child go like that. To have your heart ripped out, because we as moms, we adore our kids. Our kids are a part of us. They were inside of us. I mean, that's just a miracle in itself. And then when the child gets to come back home, you see, God knew a mother's heart. He knew that she would be the best thing for Moses. He knew that he was going to learn faith from this woman of God. He knew that she had to breathe and you know, get inside of his heart and his life. Moses was a changed man because of his mother's faith. And you and I today, we're raising kids, and we maybe you're a grandma, maybe you're an auntie and your uncle, you're going, I do not have kids, and I'm so glad I do not have kids. But maybe you are going, no, I want that child. But they're telling me I can't. Listen, fear is always going to come in many different forms. It knocks at our door. It comes to deplete our faith. It comes to rob us of our future. It comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But listen, we as the body of Christ have to put ourselves in Jochebed's position. We have to tap into the will of God and turn our hearts on with faith and believe God for the impossible with our children. Because it is their life. We have to pour faith into them. We have to believe God for them. We have to teach them faith. You see, faith just is something that you can learn, but it is also caught. I sat under the most two amazing people that I can say in the whole world. They are the best parents in the world. And faith is something that rang through our house. I will never forget a time that I was sick. We lived in the mountains, and we went to school, you know, when it snowed. And so, like, it snowed, and I was like, oh, I don't feel good, you know, and I just wanted to get out of school. And I remember my mom saying, well, you can show the devil that you're a wimp and stay home, or you can show him that you're healed and that he can't touch you. You get up, get in faith, and go to school. And I was like, what am I supposed to do with that? I mean, of course, I have to get up. I have to go to school. You see, what you do, what you say, what we act like, what we teach our children begins to get on the inside of them. It begins to teach them faith. And when fear comes, they go, oh, I don't like that because I didn't grow up with that. That's not something that's common for me in my life. I'm going to reject that, and I'm going to turn to God, and I'm going to go after faith. I'm going to reach out and believe God for the impossible. What, you're telling me I can't do that? I'm not good enough? No, I serve a big God who knew me who before I was born, who knew me in my mother's womb, who knew that I had a plan and a destiny. You see, this is what God wants for the kingdom of God. He wants your children, your children's children, your children's 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 children to be blessed. And faith is the way that they are blessed. Faith is something that we have to walk in. Because when fear comes in and grips our heart, if fear would have gripped Jochebed's heart, where would have that would have never happened. Moses would have never delivered the Israelites. He would have never parted the Red Sea. He would have never seen Jesus in a burning bush. He would have never brought the Ten Commandments to the Israelites. What? Whoa. That's crazy. All started with a little mom believing God for the impossible, trusting and walking in faith. You see, it's not easy to walk in faith. Sometimes it's easier to walk in fear. Fear will cripple you. It will make your world really small. It will damage your future. It will control your body, your mind, and your heart. But if you can learn that, no, that is a spirit of fear, and I rebuke it in the name of Jesus, and I am a daughter of God, my children are going to serve the Lord. I got a bad report about them, but you know what? I know God who is greater in me than is greater than is in that is in the world. He is going to win. My children are healed. My husband was up here one night, and he was going to preach on faith. And as he's preaching, I'm driving to the hospital because my son stopped breathing. And I'm getting my son admitted into the hospital. And as I was sitting in that waiting room by myself, the fear jumped on me. Man, that thing's a spirit, so don't fool yourself. You tell that thing to go back to hell when it tries to jump on you. And it came on me. I was like, you're a bad mom. You should have gotten him the shot for this. You should have did it. Well, by the way, there wasn't a shot for it. Thank God I found out. And I mean, I was just, it was coming at me. Like, you just missed it. You didn't do good. This is all your fault. And I had to literally stand up and go, no. He's healed. He's not going to have breathing problems. He's going to preach the gospel. He's going to play baseball because that's what he wants to do. And he is going to do the things that he wants to do because he's a son of the Most High God. And I had to stir myself up. Listen, you're going to have to stir yourself up. No one's going to come around and be like, come on, get in faith. We're going to do it here at church. But when you're alone and the enemy's coming at you, you think Jochebed wasn't sitting in her house and hiding for 3 months and fear wasn't coming in and saying, what are you doing? What are you doing? Every time there was a knock on the door, every time something happened, she had to trust in who made Moses. She had to trust that he had a purpose and a plan. She had to trust that her faith was the pathway to his future. You are the ones fighting for your children. Teach them to serve God. Teach them to believe the impossible. Teach them to walk in faith. And you do that by praying. You do that by getting with God. You do that by getting on your knees for your kids and believing. You do that by an example. Here's Jochebed. She trusted God with Moses' life. And then when Moses went to be a man of God, he was in a circumstance, many of them, where he had to choose fear or faith. And he chose faith. And because of it, everyone in Israel was delivered. That is a powerful testimony of a little mom who chose to believe in faith and not walk in fear. Today, we are going to, as a Rock Church and World Outreach Center, we're going to raise our families in faith. We're going to believe God for the impossible. When you get a bad report and fear wants to jump on you, say, no, in the name of Jesus, my child is going to live and not die. My child is going to come back from the highways and serve God with all of their hearts. My child will shout his name and make his name famous. If you're a single mom in here, you're not raising your kids by yourself. You're raising them with the Most High God. No one better could help you along. You see, God has a purpose and a plan, and he operates, as Pastor Deborah taught us, through faith. Everything comes through faith. So when fear tries to come, you just kick fear out, and you say, nope, I'm going to get myself in faith. We're going to get ourselves in faith and turn that situation around for the goodness and the things of God. I'll tell you one last story. My son, Micah, he is an amazing kid. He's pretty crazy, but now he's pretty calm. But when he came out, he was 10 pounds, 4 ounces. He has 3 extra teeth. He got sick. All of his nails fell off. I mean, he's just crazy. When he grows, his skin literally peels off of his body. Like, he's massive. And we call him Little Hercules because he's already, like, totally cut up, you know? I'm just letting you know, if any of your daughters come near him, I am not going to be happy. There's applications being taken now. And Micah is my dream boy. But Micah began, we went to the doctors for something, and the day after we left the doctor, he began twitching. And I mean twitching like Tourette's syndrome twitching, just like this, and he couldn't stop. And we're sitting at the table, Dan and me, and we would just cry. We'd sit there at dinner and we would cry. Because to see your son in pain, and he was embarrassed, so he didn't like going to school, and people were always asking him, you know, what are you doing? Why do you do that all the time? And he didn't know why, and it was something he could not control. And it was so uncomfortable for us as a family. And I remember it was one night we were sitting across the table and he was trying to talk and it was actually impairing his speech. He would try and get a sentence out and he couldn't finish a sentence. And poor guy, we were sitting there and I just had tears running down my face. And I remember looking at Dan and he was kind of wiping his tears too. And I know Micah saw us crying. And at that moment I could have just given into it and said, you know, Mike, I'm just so sorry that this is happening to you and I don't know why. Da, 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 da. No, I had a choice. I had to sit across that table and we had to tell Micah, we're going to get in faith over this. This is not of God. This does not have to stay. This has to go in the name of Jesus. And Micah, we are going to start praying. Every time you feel that you're twitching, every time you feel like you can't finish a sentence, every time you feel like that evil thing has come on you, you say, in the name of Jesus, I'm healed. And I have the peace of God, and God is healing me. If you know Micah, he would walk around saying it. And we would remind him all the time, Micah, what do you say? Micah, what do you say? Micah, what do you say? That thing went from his head, and it was the craziest thing. It went all the way through his body. I mean, he twitched his arms, he twitched his legs, and then it just left. And he has stopped twitching. It was a process. It was a faith walk. It didn't just happen overnight. That was probably a good year and a half of us every single day saying the same thing, believing God for the impossible to be possible. Listen, choose faith. Choose faith for your children. They need you to fight. They need you to be an incredible mother and parent and father, because if you don't fight for them, who will? Love your kids. Teach them faith. Teach them faith. I'm asking you today, church. I'm asking you today to choose faith. If you came in today and you're broken, you don't have to be. You don't have to be broken. You could choose to love God, to reach on and hold up and hang on to what he has for you, because he's a good God and he loves you. He loves your children. He loves your grandchildren. He loves your future generations to come. If you're a single mom and you have those moments of breakdown, it's okay. Have your moment of breakdown, but then get back up on your feet, get yourself in faith, and keep going. I love you guys. Thank you so much for letting us speak into your lives today. And I just know that God has new futures and new hopes and new destinies for this family. And so I would just want to pray over you. Do you mind if we pray? Dear God, we just come before you. And Lord, we lift up every parent in this room, every grandparent. And Lord, we ask right now that you would give them courage, that you would give them strength, that you would lead them and guide them in their prayer time. That, Lord, that you'd open every door that needs to be opened and close the doors that need to be closed. Lord, I pray that faith would arise, God, and that they and their children would walk by faith and not by sight. And Lord, that their children would grow and speak your name. And Lord, make your name famous to their generation. And Lord, all because their moms and their dads and their grandmas, their aunties and their uncles taught them faith. And we rebuke fear in the name of Jesus. You foul spirit, you have no place over the body of Christ, over the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. The people here are called by God. They're blessed. They're anointed. And Lord, I pray that their households would be households of peace, households of love, and households of faith in the name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. This is what we're going to do. The service is not over yet. Can I please have everyone sit down? Respect what God is doing in here, because we're not done talking. This has been an amazing service, but God's not done with us yet. And I wanted to just have a little chat with you and ask you a couple questions. So during this time, put your listening ears on and really pay attention to what it is that we're talking about. Because God loves you so much that he went to a cross, bloody, beaten, stripped, so that your sins can be forgiven, so you can be healed and you can live a life of freedom. All because he loved you. And he asks us to come to him, to ask him to come into our hearts and be the Lord and Savior of our lives. And if you were to walk out of this room today and you got hit by a car, or maybe you got in a car accident and you were to die and pass, where would you wake up? Would you wake up in heaven? Would you wake up in hell? Ask yourself that question. You may be examining some things in your heart and going, well, I just really kind of don't know. I kind of hope I'll make it to heaven. We cannot hope your way into heaven. You go, I think I'll make it to heaven. You know, my parents brought me to church my whole life, and you know, that's just kind of been how we did things. You can't just think your way into heaven. You can't get to heaven because your parents brought you your whole life. You say, well, I am an American, you know, I do American things. I believe in God. I know he's there. I know, but he wants a relationship with you. And you're not just saved. You don't make it to heaven just by knowing that he's God. You have to believe in your heart and accept him as your Lord and Savior. You see, today is the day that he is calling you home, if you have never asked Jesus to come into your heart and be the Lord and Savior of your life, it is the most amazing thing in the whole world. There's a new hope, a new future, and a new destiny like we talked about today. Maybe you say, well, there was a time in my life when I had asked God to come into my heart, and then I kind of walked away from the things of God, and I did my own thing, and really haven't served God from that point on. I'm talking to you today. Today, make sure you're right with God. We're going to give you an opportunity in just a second. You say, well, you know, I've kind of been walking the fence. You know, I love God, but I do my own thing. I really don't want to, you know, walk with the Lord. I really don't want to do what it is he's asked of me. The Word of God says that if you love me, you will keep my commandments. That you will walk with him. You will do what it is he's taught us and longed for us to be in a relationship with him. You say, well, fine, then how do I get to heaven? You're talking about this God. How do I ask him to come into my heart? Jesus says you have to be born again to enter the kingdom of heaven. You say, how do I be born again? Nicodemus, in the Bible, he was a great man. He understood the things of God. He understood all the ways of Jesus. And he said, I don't get it, Jesus. How do I be born again? I can't go back into my mother's womb and be born again. And Jesus says to him, no, you're not getting it, Nicodemus. What is born of flesh is flesh, but what is born of the Spirit is spirit. You have to ask Jesus and pray. Ask him to come into your heart and be the Lord and Savior of your life. He's a gentleman. He's not going to just break in and do what he wants to do. He has to be welcomed in. Then you link up with Jesus, and you're no longer walking life alone. There's no longer no power behind what it is that you're doing in life. But you have a God who is leading you and guiding you and directing you. You will have your purpose and destiny. Some of you are in this room, and you've been searching. I've been searching for something, been looking for something. That's because you were created by him, and your heart longs to be back with your creator. So today, this is what we're going to do. I'm going to count to three, and I'm going to tap my hand on the microphone like this. And when I do that, I want you to raise your hand. I say, oh no, she wants me to do this in front of everybody. Yeah. And the reason why is because Jesus died on a cross, stripped, bloody, broken for you. He was bold about freedom. He was bold about saving us from our sin. He gave everything for us so that we could go before the throne room of God, spotless. And all he's asking is that you would acknowledge that, yes, I want God. Yes, I want that God you're talking about. Yes, I want to know this amazing God that you guys have preached about today. This is going to be your time, your opportunity. You see, in the Bible, it also says that if you confess, Jesus says that if you confess me before man, that's all of us, then when you get to heaven, he will confess you before the Father. But if you deny him before man, then he will deny you before the Father. There's only one way, and that's through Jesus. So today, make sure that you are right with God. If you have never asked Jesus to come into your heart and be the Lord and Savior of your life, on the count of three, I'm talking to you. If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm talking to you. If you have been doing more of your thing than God's thing, make sure to get right with God. Do not play games with God. On the count of three, one, two, three. Raise your hands. One, two. Go ahead. This is a safe place. Three. Four. They weren't embarrassed. You won't be embarrassed. You say, oh, I see your hand. Thank you. Anyone else? Five. Six. Seven. We'll wait. I got you. Thank you. Don't miss this opportunity. We're not promised tomorrow. Thank you, Lord. This will be the best decision of your life, and you're worth waiting for. There's a few more. Eight. I see your hand. Anyone else? I'm going to scan the room. Just wave it at me so I could see you. Wave it at me so I could see you. Okay. Well, 8 people want to know our awesome Jesus. What a celebration in the kingdom of God. This is how this is going to work. We're going to ask everyone to stand up. And as you stand up, grab your purse, your sweater, your Bible. Grab a friend next to you. If you're scared to come next to you, I'm sure somebody next to you will grab you and help you come on up. They will be a partner with you. And come forward. I'd love to meet you. We want to get to know you. Come on, let's give them a hand.
And I surrender all. And I surrender.
Take that faith step that we talked about today. Grab your stuff and come on down.
Unto thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender.
I want to invite those of you that raised your hand, or if you should have raised your hand, you come right now. Come on down. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. If you're next to somebody that raised their hand, nudge them and say, come on, friend, I'll go with you right now. They're coming. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment. Come on down right now. They're coming. They're coming. Come on. You can come too. Come on. Even if you didn't raise your hand, just make your way to the front right now. But if you raised your hand, this is your moment. This is your time. Come on down. Come on down. Come on. We're waiting for you. We're cheering you on. This is your time. They're still coming. They're still coming. Come on. We'll wait for you too. Come on down.
I surrender all.
All right. Well, thank you for coming. Those of you that came, that took boldness, that took faith, and it took courage, and I'm proud of you. So what we're going to do is I'm going to send you over here. See, this is Reverend Antonio, and he's going to pray a prayer with you, because you don't get saved by just raising your hand and coming forward. You have to pray and ask Jesus to come into your heart and be the Lord and Savior of your life, and your new future will begin there. And then all these people behind you, if you could see them, you could say hi to them. These are our spiritual personal trainers. We give away friends here at The Rock. So they'll meet with you. They'll help you along. They'll connect with you and teach you the new things about this new life, this new beginning with Jesus, so you're not alone in it. And that they will help guide you and help you through this new walk in your new journey with Jesus, okay? So if you would turn with Pastor or Reverend Antonio, and let's give them a hand as they go.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to The Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.